maintain your poise at all cost, because the Holy Spirit is trying to get your attention by everything that happens in your life. Don't take it personally. Just take it as a clue. All right? So, what we're doing here is right spiritual practice. When we do right spiritual practice, we are a member of responsible society, actually. And this is the society that you want to get into, for sure. Right spiritual practice comes before everything else. It's the number one priority. It's our sole responsibility here in this world. What we're going to do right now is a practice that I was given this morning. And let's see if it interests you. I'm sure it will interest some of you out there. Okay? Taking whatever is in front of me, a plant. Okay, there's plants here. There's a plant. This plant as it is fee collection free. This plant as it is totally fee collection free. It's a fee collection free plant. This table as it is fee collection free. This post as it is fee collection free. This hedge as it is fee collection free. This palm tree as it is totally fee collection free. That wall as it is fee collection free. That tree as it is fee collection free. That tree as it is fee collection free, is a fee collection tree. Try to say that. That tree as it is a fee collection tree, is a fee collection free tree. That tree is a fee collection free tree. So that house as it is a fee collection free house. That house is free of all fee collection duties. That road is a fee collection free road. That road is free of all fee collection duties. This planet is a fee collection free planet. This universe is a fee collection free universe. Okay, you get the idea. What are we doing there? First of all, let us state something very important, and that is, each one of us has our own universe, actually. Because each one of us, from the level of perception, is perceiving a different universe. Now, though all those universes are one in the universe of universes, each one of us has the power to set our universe free. So you wonder, if we set the universe free, how come everybody else isn't free? Because it's our universe that we set free. We have the power and the will and the capacity easily to lift damnation off of our universe entirely. Lift death off of our universe entirely. Now, what I saw this morning is that we have bound our universe to the idea of collecting fees, collecting money for all sorts of various reasons. Fees, you know, whatever it is. And we want our whole universe to be collecting fees. And this is why we're so stressed out. We're thinking, I gotta get the fees from them, I gotta get the fees from them. And so many, their whole psyche is actually bound up in getting money, fees, for whatever you do. So what we can do is we can set our universe free, everything in it is free, everything, without exception. My universe is a fee collection free universe. My universe is a fee collection free universe. There's nothing in my universe that is obligated in the slightest bit to collect any fees at all. See, we want like a slave universe, everything working for us to collect, get, build up specialness. Liberate it from that. I live in a fee collection free universe. My universe is fee collection free. This plant, as it is fee collection free. It's a fee collection free plant. That tree is a fee collection free tree. This walkway is a fee collection free walkway. It is absolutely free of all fee collection duties, responsibilities. I've lifted the demand. You can lift the demand off of you, your universe. That's what these practices are for, is to relinquish your demands, to release your demands, say, no, I'm no longer placing this demand upon my universe. From the standpoint of perception, there are all these different universes. From every single angle of perception, it's a different universe, actually. And all those abide in the universe of universes, pure spaciousness. So that's why we can free our universe. Another thing we do is we insist that the things in our universe be attracted to one another. We can say, I live in an attraction-free universe. I live in an attraction-free universe. This plant is an attraction-free plant. This plant, as it is an attraction-free plant. That dirt, as it is attraction-free dirt. Okay, it's not it has no attraction to anything else, and nothing else has any attraction to it. This bottle, as it is an attraction-free bottle. Nothing is attracted to this bottle, and this bottle is not attracted to anything. This world is an attraction-free world. Nothing in this world is attracted to anything in this world. And anything in this world is not attracted to this world. It's an attraction-free world. There is no attraction at all in my world, in my universe, you're saying. And of course, no attraction, also no repulsion. This desk as it is totally attraction free. That flower as it is totally attraction free. Stone border as it is totally attraction free. That car as it is totally attraction free. The sky as it is totally attraction free. The sidewalk as it is totally attraction free. That building as it is totally attraction free. It's an attraction free building. My universe, this universe, will say, this universe as it is totally attraction free. This is an attraction-free universe. So we have one practice dealing with collecting fees, money, getting, collecting fees, wanting everyone, everything to be working for you, to collect fees and demanding fees of everything else. And we're saying, I live in a my universe is a fee-collecting free universe. And the second is attraction. Just one moment. All right, back. Some very interesting stuff just happened, as a matter of fact. Just a whole constellation went after another. It's pretty incredible. Right spiritual practice is what protects us, what saves us. The world is not going to ascend so much. There's going to be a descent taking place. And the ones that don't descend we'll be freed up from those that do dissent, and it will seem like a huge burden off of us in many ways. And that burden off of us may result in also some rising. It's like, say something is in the ocean, like, and there's, it's got a chain and a heavy weight tied to it, and there's something that's buoyant, but it's down deep in the ocean because it's got this heavy weight, and the heavy weight, the chain breaks, the heavy weight falls to the bottom of the ocean, and this buoyant ball or whatever it is rises up, and eventually, slowly rises up, and eventually surfaces. It's kind of like that is what's going to happen. Now, what I got today is that there are a lot of renegades on this planet now, a lot of piratical people, pirates, renegades, very people who are extremely loyal to the ego and its plan of eternal death. And they've been kind of forced onto this planet from various other cosmic situations that are taking place, cosmic politics, and it's like in the Bible they say that the fallen angels at the end times will all lose their footholds elsewhere and end up on this planet. Well, that's what's happened. We have a lot of quote-unquote fallen angels on this planet right now. It's a very nasty place right now. And of course they want to descend. They want to descend. They can't stand the light that is here on this planet, spiritual light. They want to descend away from it. They want to pursue the idea of permanent hiding from God, where there's no evidence of God anywhere. They don't want any help. They want to be completely free, so they're pursuing this. Now, what I got from the Holy Spirit today was, let them go. Don't pursue them. You'll make it worse. They'll run even further. See, when their goal is to try and get completely free of God, don't pursue them. God doesn't want us to pursue them. It's a very amazing insight. Let them go. And God says, they'll eventually and rather quickly realize how awful their situation is, and then they'll change their minds, and then they'll listen. But God does not want us to pursue the dark ones at this time. Let them go. That's why I say sidestep those situations. Stay on the sidelines. Stay out of it, essentially. Stay out of it. Don't try to pursue them and say, look, I got the answer for you. I can help you. They'll just run even deeper into darkness if you do that. That's, I understand that. And of course, only pride would get you to pursue them, thinking, well, you know, God can't help them, but I can. Something like that. They don't want to listen to God, but they'll listen to me. That's bad. See, that's very bad. That's probably the dynamic that hooks many of us, probably hooked me, is thinking, these people won't listen to God at all, but I think I'll be able to approach them. They'll listen to me. And they didn't want to, you know, no way. They just fled and says, nah, you're saying the stuff that God wants you to say. Ah, it's terrible. We're fleeing from you. It's really like that. So we have to swallow our pride and say, you know what? There's a time to help, and there's a time to step back for a while. You got to know the difference. And again, if you try to help in certain situations, you will make the situation a lot worse. They will retreat even deeper into projection. And that will make things worse for them. And then you'll get enmeshed in that dynamic too, and it'll make things worse for you. So we're coming across a time right now where we simply need to step back, go to some place, go to a refuge, right spiritual practice, and let those who want to descend, and there are a lot on this planet, very heavy, they want to go descend to a lower realm, as it were. This place is too much spiritual light here for them. They want to go to a place where there's no spiritual light at all. No Holy Spirit, no grace, nothing. No right teachings, no spiritual practices, nothing. That's their utopia. And they're pursuing it with you know, fanaticism. Let them do it. Don't try to stop them. later on, they'll change their mind, but not yet. And when they do change their mind, having done your spiritual practices, you will be used to dwelling in an enlightened universe, and you will take that enlightened universe with you wherever you go. And then people, you will be able to help them. People will look at you and say, "My gosh, what are you? You look like you're living in a paradise." And you say, "I am. I am." And then, you know, they'll say, "Wow, I mean, I'm kind of tired of living in this really terrible, dark, horrible jungle. You know, I think I like what you have better." And then you can start the turnaround, process of turnaround, get them right spiritual practice. Very, very interesting stuff is going on. Yeah, and I've been given the indication that there's going to be like at least a three-year period of very, very strong descent in this world. And as a matter of fact, it's happening. I said what yesterday or the day before. I was saying that it is after President's Day, and then that this week it's going to get. Certainly in March, a black swan event is going to push it so much. But I said it's going to generalize, that there's a mood in the world of specifically condemning spiritual light. And it's going to generalize into a total global zero tolerance policy is what's going to happen. And it could happen, you know, just like boom, like that. Really fast, really, really fast, and the Inquisition will start. The Inquisition, of course, is to get rid of the spiritual light in this world, and so they can make this world a dark, 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 dark hiding place. Very dark. They want to abide in darkness. That's why they call them children of darkness. They want to abide in darkness, spiritual darkness. And of course, in order to do that, you can't have any lights in the cave, can you? They gotta extinguish all the lights. So it's easy for us. All we have to do is choose, you know, my path will be the path of spiritual practice. It's not difficult. Can't have it both ways, no way. Now, as far as doing these practices, trying to do these practices while you're out in the world is very difficult. I can't even do them. It's difficult. I'm struggling, but we have to learn how. But it's much easier if you're in a quiet mood of repentance like I'm doing right here. And you have a place where you go, where that's all you do. That is the place where you focus on this. That is a lot easier. A lot easier. So don't be concerned if you're out in public and all these distractions are hitting you and you can't practice very well. Now who can really? That's not a sign of failure at all. When I'm driving, it's just, you know, you're just on autopilot, then that's pretty easy. It's possible to practice just while you're driving. But when you're interacting with people, no, I find it very difficult, not impossible. Probably we'll be able to get there some point, maybe even soon, being able to do that. But no, temper, you know, it just knocks it out. It tends to distract you very badly. That's okay, no worries. And we're not looking for any specific results. We're just realize that it'll automatically generalize for us. And you'll notice great progress on your path. Like you'll suddenly see something that's been holding you back for lifetimes, and now you realize it's gone. It's not going to bother you anymore. Like that. And it just gradually you were deep down in the ocean. You're gradually rising up. Gradually you're rising up, and you look around and you notice after a while, hey, there's a lot more light. You know, I see a lot more light. But it's slow, sort of gently and slowly, like like a bubble rising in oil, just really nice and smooth and slow. And I see a whole lot more light as you're getting closer to the surface. Of course, much more light penetrates through the ocean, to the water. And so you say, wow, I'm really making a lot of progress. But it's very sort of smooth and steady. You don't notice, it's not so abrupt, right? We're not aiming for anything abrupt. Not aiming for anything abrupt. Even the breakthroughs that I've had, I was practicing. Actually, while I was driving, and I felt the practice get very intense. I was really feeling it so strong. And then just gently, it just seemed like, you know, I looked around, and I just said, I get it. It's like that. This is not abrupt. There was nothing abrupt about it. We're not looking for abruptness. Just the contrary, smoothness. So, yesterday I took a look at some news articles. The Holy Spirit said, why don't you take a peek at this? Because you've been saying it's going to crystallize, it's going to generalize, and it's coming now. Wouldn't you know it, right on cue. Oh my gosh. The news articles that are headlined in our paper and the stuff that's coming out is just right on cue. It's extreme totalitarian viewpoints. Being presented as if nobody in their right mind could possibly be against it, you know. In other words, a value system that is people are saying this value system is the only one there is, and it's obvious it's right, and there's no debate. The debate is closed. You know, the debate is what you're going to get is this overall generalized mood is that the debate is over. Okay, now it's time for action. That's what we're going to get. That's why we heard. This is 2:14. It's going to be your action from the chief, you know, the chief in the big white house. And at least the chief of a certain tribe, political tribe, and year of action. What action? Action means the debate is finished, right? The debate is finished. So we're headed, I say, in March. We're headed into a time where this action will commence, meaning the debate is finished, and then it's time to start, you know, cracking heads as far as those who refuse to acknowledge the debate has been finished and the issue has been decided. Yeah, these issues. We don't have time. They'll say, we don't have time. We can't waste any more time on debate and talking about these things have been decided, and now you need to conform to what's been decided. Period. Zero tolerance. Good old zero tolerance policies. But here, there is perfect fairness in that you simply do spiritual practice, right? Spiritual practice first. Doesn't matter what valuing system the ego has taught you, or taught someone else, or whatever. It doesn't matter. You simply say, look, I don't have a debate problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a totalitarian problem, I have a continuity problem. This is the root practice, okay. Well, the even before that, the mood of repentance is the first all-important discipline. And you can do that in every circumstance when you're out in the world. You can really keep that going. Secondly, is this simple practice of whatever problem you have. Let's say you feel distracted, I can't practice. You say, I don't have a distraction problem, I have a continuity problem. Or I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. This is the root practice. And it works wonders for you, absolute wonders. Because it centers you and stabilizes you and puts the power in your universe in your hands, actually. Because you're looking, basically you're saying, in my universe, the only problem I have is the continuity problem. That's it. which is holding my will back from lifting my demands of specialness off of my universe. But as soon as I keep working on this continuity issue and realize there is a resolution, the vision of oneness, then I know I'll be able to lift my demands off of my universe, that everything in my universe be special. In other words, have a identity, separate identity based on location and form and appearance, okay? You can lift that demand off of your universe, but you don't because of the continuity problem. So first step is to say, you know, in my universe, there's only one problem in my universe. You can look at it that way. In my universe, there's only one problem. I only have one problem in my universe, and that's the continuity problem. Now, if somebody else wants to say that they've got a whole bunch of problems, fine, that's their universe. But in my universe, there's only one problem, that's the continuity problem, and the Holy Spirit has resolved that with the vision of oneness. So only the vision of oneness has value, okay? As far as value at this point we're talking about, in my universe, only the vision of oneness has value, because that resolves the continuity issue, okay? And that enables me to set my entire universe free, absolutely free. I live in a perfectly free universe. Free of all death, suffering, misery, age, everything. My universe is no longer bound by any specialness. It's a universe of bliss. So, when you're struggling to do these more advanced, powerful techniques, such as this plant as it is perfectly free of specialness. This plant is totally free of all specialness. This is a specialness-free plant. This plant as it is totally free of all specialness. Totally free of all specialness. Totally free of all specialness. It's very liberating, but what you have to do first is the continuity practice that puts you in charge of your universe, you see. What happens is you get distracted and you forget that when you project, you're the one who's projecting your universe. You've forgotten reality, and now you're seeing a separate reality. And that everyone, all projections have their own separate reality, as it were. So you have to put yourself in charge of it. You have to admit, say, you know what? I made what I see, I made. I'm imagining all this. I'm imagining something that really isn't there, which all these separate identities, all this thingness. And so therefore I have to deal with that. And the problem is I have a continuity problem that's paralyzing my will. It's paralyzing my will. So instead of tilting at windmills and trying to deal with all these ancillary issues that only are held in place by your lack of will, okay, that's the only thing, regain your will. And say, no, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. Meaning only that which is holding my will in place, holding it back, only that's the problem. Because as soon as I liberate my will, get my will going, I can release my universe from all these demands that I placed on it. Easily. One decision. Why? I just decide it and it's done. So our real problem is the continuity problem. Absolutely. Center your will in that. You'll feel centered. You'll feel powerful. So, when you struggle with some other exercises, go back to the continuity exercise. And actually, you should start out your practice that way. Center your will. And then from there, you're able to go further. That's what I've done. I've started out with this continuity. I don't have that problem. I don't have a people problem. I have a continuity problem. And get more and more adamant. And then from there, you can add some other practice. And then generate such a powerful sense of your own will that then you're able to actually, the vision of oneness begins to dawn upon you. That's how it happens. So I don't have a dissension problem. I don't have a dissension problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem that I have. The dissension problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. This is the basic exercise. You insist that all those other problems have no value for you. Why? Because a simple decision by your will, poof, they evaporate. Totally evaporate. So struggling with any of those problems has no value for you. You can't solve any of these problems by struggling with them. It's totally based, it's a projection, which is based on your will. Okay, so having your will paralyzed and then struggling with these problems is totally the wrong way to go about it. You said you just dismiss this problem. Say, I don't have that problem. That problem has zero value for me. Solving that problem, struggling with this problem has zero value for me. When you say a problem, it means you're kind of struggling with it, right? It's a problem for you. So, I don't have a dissension problem. I have a continuity problem. Don't have a dissension problem. The only problem I have is the continuity problem. The dissension problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is the golden practice. I mean, this is it. And then off of that, your will, what happens is your will gets strengthened, and then you're able to do these other exercises that more specifically focus in on the demands that you've placed on your universe, and you begin to practice lifting those demands. Because actually in the vision of oneness, those demands have been lifted. All those demands have been lifted. So we're kind of practicing getting ready for the vision of oneness by I lift this demand, I lift this demand, I lift this demand. This plant as it is death-free. This table as it is death-free. That's another way you can practice. This air as it is death-free air. This plant as it is a death-free plant. That light as it is death-free light. That sky as it is death-free sky. This universe as it is death-free, is a death-free universe. This world as it is a death-free world. So you become capable of your will becomes stronger, and you're capable of saying these, practicing this way. Very powerful. So the general way of practicing is very clear. It's not a mystery anymore. You have an overall mood of a determination. It's a mood of repentance. That's your determination. You have then a root practice that centers your will. Okay? The centered will, and then you're able to build upon that and really get traction out of it. It's very simple. And then the goal is the vision of oneness, and it will dawn. It will start dawning upon one when they do the right spiritual practice. It's not difficult. Now, the ego goes about it, of course, completely the wrong way. It wants your will to remain paralyzed. Its goal is to bring about eternal death. And so it wants your will to be paralyzed, and except to keep projecting more and more and more and more weakness, more and more weakness, more and more weakness, which is projection. It gives a sense of weakness, as if you're no longer whole, and so your will becomes less and less and less and less and less, more and more, you know, more and more weakened and weakened and weakened. It seems like you're now vulnerable more and more and more and more to everything outside of you. It's more powerful than you are, et cetera, in your universe, et cetera. Like that, that's what the ego wants. So it emphasizes engaging with all these problems, struggling with them, which just wears you out. Because that problem isn't going anywhere unless you lift it off of your entire universe. You cannot lift it off part and keep it in somewhere else in your universe. If you lift it off one, you lift it off of everything. can't set one thing free from death and keep everything else bound to it. It's not possible. So the ego has you struggle with all these problems, which is the mistaken way to go about it. Don't struggle with these problems. Insist that you only have one problem. That pushes the ego out of the way better than anything. Just insist you have just one problem. I insist I only have one problem. I don't have an illness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an endangerment problem, I have a continuity problem. So the global zero tolerance policy should get going. You know what, it's almost March. And what I've been shown is that in March, March is when the march begins. It's a good name for the month. March is when this march begins. Basically, the global mood will be say, you know what, we've spent enough time with you, and it's now you either align with us or get out. Right? Well, what they're saying is you either descend with us or you're going to be left behind. Because see, they believe they're going towards salvation in their descension. The ego's goal, the ego tells us that eternal death, even though it packages this in ways that don't startle us too much, that eternal death, the ego believes eternal death is salvation. It just hasn't found out how to keep you dead yet. Keeps bringing back to life. It's just like in a dream, you know, your dream figure dies and suddenly, you know, another dream figure arises. Huh? What? It's just a dream. That's why the dreamer is still alive. The ego doesn't know this, doesn't realize there's a dreamer. It's just trying to figure out how to keep these dream figures dead, you know, eternally dead. So it's trying to figure that out. So it thinks that's salvation. So when it says that in leaving you behind, it thinks it's leaving you behind. It thinks that you're going into hell. You know, you're falling into the pit. You're being left behind in terrible darkness. That is going towards the light as it goes into deeper and deeper, deeper hiding and projection. That's what the ego believes. And it's its basic premise. That's what it was born as, a projection. That's what it has complete fidelity to this. And we mistake this complete fidelity of the ego as meaning it must be true then. No. It's just that it's a born liar. So of course it has fidelity to lies. It's born of confusion. Of course it has fidelity to confusion. Of course it was born, we told an ego, misdirect us. So of course it's going to misdirect us and have fidelity to misdirection. That's exactly what it does. So when the world is descending, you're not being left behind. The light, you begin to experience more and more light as this darkness, you know, departs from you, actually. But the key is don't interfere. Don't proselytize. There's a time when you have to stop proselytizing. It's called the end of the age, the end of the church age, etc. There's a time when you've done all you can do, and then you need to step back. You need to step back. Because those who are descending in the darkness, if you try to proselytize, they think that hell is after them, trying to drag them into hell. And so they'll go flee even further into their darkness, thinking that that's their safety. And it makes it more difficult, gives them more delay to come out of that. So there's a time to proselytize and help, and there's a time to step back. course, the Holy Spirit knows the difference of when to do what. There's a lot of things I could say about the times, but right spiritual practice is the key. It gets you into responsible society. Imagine dwelling in a responsible society, how awesome it would be. Now, in a responsible society, people are always, they're always working on some spiritual discipline, focus. And if they need to interact and talk about something, you know, just some basic functional situation or something, what you do is, when you come up to the person, you bow to them. And what you say, you're saying is, I recognize that you're engaged in very powerful, important spiritual practice. Do I have your permission to shift focus just for a moment on this practical function? And they bow to you, and you both bow and say, "Okay." So we're going. We realize that we're both in this deep spiritual, considerate practice, but we need to at least discuss, you know, what we're going to do with this, and that, whatever. And then when you're finished and you're doing that as quickly as possible, you bow to each other, saying, I now return you to your spiritual practice. And they bow to you, that they're saying, I now return you to your spiritual practice. And then you go back to your concentration on your spiritual practice. That is responsible society. People in responsible society are engaged in right spiritual practice. They're engaged in consideration at all times. And so, pragmatically, there are some interruptions, and they then it's acknowledged, you know, that they're interrupting spiritual practice. How many times do you see that happen in today's world? When you come up to somebody, you know, and you're asking permission, may I interrupt your intense spiritual practice for just a moment here? And then when you're done, you say, all right, please go back to your right spiritual practice. You know, you're saying, don't forget, I'm being released to the right spiritual practice again. How often do you see that in secular society, in the society, the culture? I never see it. Never. In fact, in my life, I've never seen it. Now, I understand that in some intense practices, there's traditions that do the bowing thing, but as far as actually understanding what it's all about, that you just absolutely know that whoever you see in your place, they're all engaged in right spiritual practice, and you don't interrupt them unless it's absolutely necessary, and they don't interrupt you unless it's absolutely necessary. That's a responsible society. Now, how long do you think before the vision of oneness dawns there, right? Not long. You're gonna get it soon. There's going to be a lot of awakening in such a society, for sure. It'll take its time, it'll be gentle, but there'll be a lot of awakening there. It'll be commonplace. Now, herein is another issue. In right, responsible society, where right spiritual practice is the norm, the vision of oneness becomes commonplace, relatively commonplace. Whereas in the dark, descendant, hiding places, it's like super rare. If it ever happens even at all, it's super, super rare. So the temptation of the ego is to say, hey, you know what? You could be even greater than all those. You could even be greater than God. I mean, if you're able to be enlightened in this very dark situation, if you're able to succeed the vision of oneness, doubt, just imagine how much greater you are than all those others who only succeeded because they were surrounded by this great support system, and you're going to prove that you're superior. Well, that is the essential whim of this dream that we're in, is wanting to be greater than God. So this is just a direct, you know, strong reflection of this purpose, the goal of the ego, and The ego says, whispers to you, hey, you could be greater than all everyone else. Your awakening will have more importance. You'll be seen as superior because you did it under more difficult circumstances. So that the temptation is to take that bait and say, yeah, maybe if I can succeed under these terrible circumstances, you know, that will show that I'm superior. Which is essentially the ego's plan for you, to be superior to God. But the vision of oneness is exactly the same in either circumstance. It's just a matter of how quickly. The only issue is how quickly do you do it? You know, don't waste time. Don't waste time. So do it the safe way, the easy, safe way. And don't take the ego's bait and try to do it under, you know, very extremely difficult circumstances, which are coming in the world for sure. But if you should happen to do that, then you can also awaken for sure, which is fine. There might be some daredevils who do that, or those who get tricked, etc. Well, you can still awaken for sure. Like, you just practice this wall as it is. It's totally free of all wall specialness. Everything totally free of all specialness. I'm releasing my universe from all specialness. All specialness. Totally evaporated. It was just a wishful thinking on my part, actually. I wanted to be so I was thinking it is so, but it really was never there. It can be done even under difficult circumstances, but it's not going to be any better than when, if you do it under easy circumstances. Same result. So don't let the ego fool you into thinking that that's what you need to do, just go into the descent also. So you could be have some sort of greater realization. No. More powerful realization. No, it's not more powerful. Do it the safe way. Do it the safe way. Responsible society where it becomes commonplace. That's what you're really after. And you think, well, I'm not very special then if it's so commonplace. You don't want to be special. You don't want to be historic. You want to be free. Free of all specialness. So that's a tricky trap. We maybe talk about that some more later. It's a tricky trap, but you can see it good enough, I think, that you say, yeah, you know what, obviously it's better to be in right spiritual company, where awakening is more commonplace. That'll help me out immeasurably, And trying to do it under, you know, extremely difficult circumstances is possible, but it will be extremely difficult. So, you know, why put yourself through that? So we have this option coming up, I believe, to choose the path of right spiritual practice in a situation that's supportive of it, and there'll be a lot of success there, and you'll have the opportunity to work through this issue of specialness for sure as you see others awakening. It's like, wow, okay, it's very humbling. You're still putting demands on your universe. You know, they've lifted them off their universe. So you're still putting demands for specialness on your universe. That your universe make you special, or be a special universe. Remember, you can't have specialness anywhere. It'll be everywhere. If you believe it's anywhere, you'll see it everywhere. So you're still stuck in your desire to be special. You're stuck with a special universe, so everything is special. Which means everything's completely fragmented, separated, and compounded. What's compounded can be uncompounded. So you still live in hell. So these issues can be worked through for sure. For sure. Not so difficult. Maybe that's a whole nother video, actually. I've gone over various issues before, talked about other videos before. Maybe we'll just leave it out of this video. What's to come in this world? It's pretty obvious, and it's not pleasant at all. And if we need to talk about it more, I can certainly talk about it. But in this video, we're going to stick with right spiritual practice. So, I don't have I don't have an enticement problem. I have a continuity problem. You're taking control of your universe. You say, I am in control of my universe. And the only reason why it still remains problematical for me is because my will is afraid of the continuity issue. The continuity issue is holding my will, you know, from acting, from declaring, from lifting this madness off of my universe. So I don't have a darkness problem. I have a continuity problem. That's real empowerment. It's empowering your will. And your will is what lifts all your false belief off of your universe. And belief in death, impermanence, specialness, fragmentation, depression, confusion, fear, everything. Your will lifts it off of your universe. You simply decide that it's so, and it is so. So, the continuity exercise. I don't have a fatigue problem. I have a continuity problem. When we say I don't have a problem, we mean in my universe, there is no such problem. Okay, there's only the continuity problem. The fatigue problem has zero value to me. In other words, focusing on fatigue as fatigue has no value. No value at all. Only focusing on the continuity problem has value. And the continuity problem is resolved by the vision of oneness. I don't have a security problem. There's no security problem in my universe. I only have a continuity problem. There's a continuity problem in my universe. The security problem has zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is real empowerment. For everybody. Everybody, this is their first order of business for everyone. Doesn't matter gender, age, location, no matter what parameter or variable you'd want to talk about, it doesn't matter at all. This is the first order of business. I don't have and then you name the problem, so I don't have a location problem in my universe. I don't have a location problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have, quote unquote, in my universe. This is understood. We're just using shorthand. It's the only problem I have. I don't have a specialness problem. I have a continuity problem. The specialness problem has zero value for me. Zero value. No value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a war problem. My only problem is the continuity problem. I don't have a violence problem. The only problem is the continuity problem. The violence problem has zero value for me. Zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value. I don't have a survival problem. I have a continuity problem. The survival problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And you can look at your inner world and identify these things that arise that try to get you to solve them as problems and say, no, I don't have that problem. No, I don't have that problem. I don't have that problem. I don't have a fee collecting problem in my universe. I don't have a fee collecting problem. I have a continuity problem. The fee collecting problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. I don't have an attraction problem. I have a continuity problem. The attraction problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. And then you could go on and say, this plant as it is totally free of all plant specialness. This day as it is totally free of all day specialness. This universe as it is totally free of all universe specialness. This time as it is totally free of all time specialness. This future as it is totally free of all future specialness. This past is totally free of all past specialness. This now is totally free of all now specialness. This spaciousness is totally free of all spaciousness specialness. So these practices are starting to pack a punch for me. See, starting to build up. I'm starting to feel it now. This planet is totally free of all planet specialness. This planet as it is totally free of all planet specialness. I don't have a planet problem, I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The planet problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Truth is true. Truth is always true. Only truth is true. Truth is true forever. Lies are lies forever. Lies are never true. Truth is totally true right now. As it is, truth is totally true. And you can end practicing that way or some way. But so we are basically showing here that right spiritual practice and the society of responsible society, being a member of responsible society, is very possible. It's very possible. It's not too difficult. It doesn't have to do with money. Okay? It doesn't have to do with your degree. It doesn't have to do with your career success, your family success. It doesn't have to do with worldly success at all. Being included in the club of responsible society, only way to get in is that you're doing right spiritual practice. That's the only way to get in. But you don't need any other way. It's very doable. And that's the highest class to get in for sure. It's the only class that really has value. It's the only class of society that has value. The others have no value. Zero value. Only a responsible society has value as a class for me. As a class only. responsible society has value. All the other places, you know, have no value. So whatever problems arise, you can say, well, no, in my universe, there's no such problem like that. No, only the continuity problem. That's right, spiritual practice. Now, we're not stupid. We're not trying to be stupid at all. So we do understand that on this planet, there is this push to eradicate right spiritual practice. But we counter that with right spiritual practice. We counter that with right. So we say, I don't have a right spiritual eradication problem. I do not have a right spiritual practice eradication problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. The right spiritual practice eradication problem has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So that's how you counter it. That's how you counter it. But if we don't counter it, then indeed we will, our will be paralyzed and we will experience these problems. So right spiritual practice has to do with freeing your will to free your universe from the demand of specialness upon it. Free it from projections. Abide in the vision of oneness, the one shared identity. But if we don't do right spiritual practice, then most definitely all these problems will be attacking us, and the will just not be strong enough to do anything about it, and just will cry out to God, say, "Oh God, please, all these terrible things are happening to me. You know, please take away the suffering. Please get rid of my enemies. Please do this." And you'll end up that way. That's not God's will for us. You see, we have to reestablish our will in alignment with truth and reality. So we have to free the paralysis of our will. And then, since we're the ones projecting, not God, see, we think God's projecting all this on us. No, we're projecting. We're the ones that have to stop projecting, not God. So we have to have the will to do it. So what God says to us when we're just crying about all these problems is, hey, do right spiritual practice. That's the answer. That's why people go running to the saints and the saviors and the gurus and saying, "Oh, please, I have problems. My aunt is sick and all that stuff." And they say, "Look, you do right spiritual practice right now. Use that as a leverage in your life to begin right spiritual practice." So they know, right? They know. This is what you have to do. I don't have a sick aunt problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The sick aunt problem has zero value. Only the continuity problem has value. Because the sick aunt thing is being used to paralyze your will and saying there's something outside of your will that is more powerful than your will, and you're helpless in its grasp, and you need you pray to this will. You claim that God is bringing this other more powerful will upon you, and you say, "God, please let up on me, please, it's too much." You're begging to this will, but you're just idolizing your own projection when you do that. You're just engaging in idolatry. So don't ask God to remove your suffering. Ask God to show you right spiritual practice. And that's how you really will remove your suffering. More than remove your suffering, you will enter into this universe of total gratitude towards you. Your universe will have total gratitude towards you. And you will feel like you totally belong. And your whole universe will recognize where it is, which is your spirit. You'll remember that you're spirit. And then the love between creation and the created, the creator and create and the created, this unending stream, you'll begin to remember it. You know, that's what'll happen. And you'll be rehabilitated. Your continuity problem will be totally resolved for you at some point, because the remembrance will be, have completed its task. So as much as possible in your prayer, say, ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, please tell me what right spiritual practice is. That's what I've been doing. That's my prayer. In the morning I say, Holy Spirit, what is my right spiritual practice for this day? Show me that I may practice. And every day the Holy Spirit gives me this right spiritual practice, very powerful stuff. All right, well, rain is returning, it's going to return in California, starting tonight, maybe in several hours time, and it's supposed to rain heavily all night and heavily all during most of the day. A real soaker this time, which is great, but everything just soaked up the last rain. It's like already looks dry again almost. It's amazing. The land is so parched here. So, just gonna get this video up. And it's just continuing to encourage. If you can't do any practice, just say, I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. You can do that. That's like spiritual jujitsu, actually. Spiritual jujitsu. You can do it. Because the ego's keeping you from practicing, and then just say to the ego, hey, ego, I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. And you immediately flip the ego on its back. That's kind of fun to do, flipping the ego like that. All right, so I'll catch you on the flip side. Thanks for watching. That's it for this one.